Hello, everyone. Welcome. My name is Marilyn Shannon, and I welcome you today to the Breaking Free Show. It's so nice to have you here. Happy day to everybody, wherever you are, in whatever part of the world you are watching us from. It's an honor, and I know that your time is precious. So thank you so much for sharing it with us today. And, you know, I take it as a personal thing to each and every week bring you a great story, something really that you can take to your heart, that you listen to and you make a difference in your life. And each and every week, that's my mission. So before I get on with my show and I introduce my guest to you, I want to say hi to Amnon.
Hello, Marilyn.
He's
how
busy,
are you?
Busy, busy. You know, Amnon's always busy over there.
Busy.
You're a busy man. So Amnon, without Amnon, we wouldn't be here. So Amnon, thank you.
You wouldn't be here.
No, I wouldn't be here because if you're not here, I'm not here. So how are things going?
Things are just fine.
Yeah, you had a good weekend.
It's getting kind of chilly now.
Yeah, well.
Can you imagine we say 60 is chilly?
Look, we had 80-degree weather over the weekend. And in February, that's kind of like beautiful, great, but it shouldn't happen. It's kind of like a mistake. But anyway, let me just invite you all to take part in our chat. So please feel free to put your name, nickname, whatever you like under our video. And you can be in our live chat and you can ask questions and comment from right from there. And anytime during the show, you are welcome to call in to 919-518-9773. Anytime, any comment, this is an open invitation. This, like, you know how they say this land is your land, this land is my land? Well, this show is your show, this show is my show, and together we make it happen. So please feel free, 919-518-9773. And you can also contact us through Skype at computers, that's plural, 2K voice. Anytime during the show when the moment moves you, please feel free. So let me introduce my guest to you today, Dr. Jamila Battle.
Hello.
Hi.
Hello.
Great.
Good to have you here.
Thank you for having me here.
It's a pleasure. So I'm going to ask Dr. Battle, my friend Jamila, to go ahead and just tell us who she is. Update us. Like, who are you now?
Okay.
Who are you now?
Dr. Jamila Battle, myself, I am triple board certified physician in family medicine, sleep medicine, and addiction. I'm also a best-selling author, number one bestseller in five categories on Amazon to the book From Abuse to Abundance, Reboot Your Soul, Repair Your Heart, Rebirth into Prosperity. A speaker and a consultant, also a mother of three, a wife, and a friend.
Okay. And a woman, right?
Yeah.
Okay, so Jamila, mm-hmm. I want to start with, I read your book, and it really is a very powerful book, and I get to read lots of books here. Lots of people sending me lots of books, and this one truly blew me away. Truly, truly, truly. So share with our audience about your life.
Okay. So as you know, in the book, basically my dad, just to kind of start out and give you a little bit of background, was a well-known, famous jazz musician of his time. He played with many of the greats back from the late 20th century. He played with Stanley Turrentine, composed lots of jazz compositions, you know, George Benson. So many of the greats. I was an organist and a pianist and well-known internationally. And on our outside, our lives looked perfect. But on the inside, it was like we were trapped in the prison, literally. Bars were on the window, as you know. The phones were tapped, and we shared our house with rats and bats. Oftentimes, these rodents were used to torture us. It wasn't uncommon for me to be bound to duct tape and beaten with wire. But on one day, I decided to be courageous.
Okay, but yes. Before we go there, I want to just reiterate. So her dad was this amazing musician. His name was
Butch Cornell.
So he was just amazing, right? But she
Absolutely.
Lived a life of hell. She and her brother, and yes. a sister mm-hmm. and her mother, for the most part, lived a life of hell. Now, your mother was not a musician, but right. what about her? Tell us some things about her.
So my mom met my dad when she was 16 and fell into the trap of domestic violence. And so if you don't know, domestic violence is about power and control. And my dad was 16 years older than her, unbeknownst to her. And at the time, she had already lost her father when she was 5. And then she lost her mother when she was 16. So when she met my dad became her world. And he was very charismatic. Everyone loved him, including my mother. And so she fell into the traps of domestic violence, which doesn't announce itself as I'm going to trap you and make you a victim. So the first step was to isolate her from family and friends. And then, you know, he began to control her and it became very abusive. So when she was very young, an age of 16, you know, she felt like she had nothing. She was trapped. And that's basically how she, you know, became a victim and very, very much paralyzed with fear as we were growing up.
And were you the oldest, the middle? What were you?
I was the oldest.
So yes. did that come with extra torture?
That did. So being the oldest, a lot of times I felt compelled to kind of protect my siblings and do things that my mom, you know, was too afraid to do. So she would sometimes be, like I mentioned, paralyzed in fear. And when my father would switch, you know, from kind of being in a good mood and then really kind of switch to rage and anger, which is very, you know, common in a household full of addiction. And he had an addiction with drugs. And going from those extremes, a lot of times, whomever was in the way is kind of, that's who would be attacked. Rather, it was, you know, with his hands or wires or his words. And so me being the oldest, I would, as I started to become older and kind of more defiant, so to speak, I would step in, you know, unbeknownst to me as a child. You know, we're not supposed to be stepping in, but that's the role I took. And so a lot of the pain to bear, I carried.
And what were you like as a child?
So I was, that's such a great question, very curious. My mama said when I came out the womb, it seemed like I was just, here I am, and I wanted to know who, what, when, where, and why. And very much a reader and wanted to kind of discover what was possible. So I always asked myself questions and wanted to know really kind of at an early age when things didn't feel right. That felt like an error to me. It's felt like my life had been hijacked. So I wanted to know, what if it could be better? Is there some good in the world? And that curiosity, I'm just so grateful, never died, because that's really what saved my life and my family.
You know, I would imagine that there were times that being that way also caused more pain.
It did, because when you're very passionate about wanting to know why, and you're looking and you're digging and you're searching, sometimes you don't get answers that you want. You don't get pretty answers, or sometimes it was, I'm in the family business, I'm poking my nose around too much, and that consequence would be another beating or an argument that would start.
Mm-hmm. Was your father ever calm? Was he ever, for any length of time, just a daddy?
Yeah, that's such a good question. There were times, we had a summer of love, one of my favorite chapters in the book, when his mother came down to visit with us. And he was pretty calm that summer. His mom was there to keep him in check, which gave us a bit of a reprieve and a break, and we could be kids for once and play. And I remember one time when he did feel comfortable enough to start some drama. I mean, she diffused it very quickly, and I was just like, what power does Grandmama have?
She was also kind of tough, too, wasn't she, to you?
She was tough, and when I discovered during that summer, I thought, I'm going to tell my grandma right away when I get a chance what her son's doing. And when I discovered, you know, after coming to her and right before I, you know, opened my mouth to tell her what was going on, and she asked to touch me in a sexual way, and I had been touched at this point by my father sexually. At this point, I was about 9. I kept my mouth closed, and that's when the questions started kind of flooding in. Okay, what happened to Dad? Does this go back further than, you know, back in the family history, kind of further back?
It's, I mean, really and truly, everyone, this really is an incredible book. It's, I mean, I found I could not put it down, and it was painful, and yet it was, also there were periods of rejoicing. So it is really incredible, because you really, I mean, you know that it's probably one of the worst stories I've heard, but it's probably not the only worst story anybody's ever heard or lived through. So it's really a testament to Jamila to be the person she is, to be able to have had the wherewithal, the foresight, the curiosity, the drive, the passion to be able to come out of there and to, you know, find her way out and to, you know, end up as a, you know, a medical doctor. But we're going to get to that in just a few minutes, because I think, you know, I want to ask you something before we get to that part. Is this type of behavior rampant, do you know, within the music industry?
You know, that's a very good question. I believe so. There are lots of drugs and addictions in the music industry, and oftentimes addiction and mental illness coexist. And also, when we're talking mental illness and addictions, we unfortunately see that there's trauma. Addiction can be basically a kind of an ineffective poor coping mechanism for covering up some type of pain. And so it's my conjecture or guess that my dad was covering up a lot of pain, which fueled his addiction. And it didn't help that he was also in the jazz industry. And there were songs he'd written that he'd had to give up to kind of play the game. And
wait, what do you mean by that?
Give up, like, songs he's composed, and then he'd have to basically give that away to kind of make it in the music business. Mm-hmm. So back in that day, it was very hard. We certainly didn't have things like iTunes, and, you know, it was harder to have a platform as an independent artist who was kind of really the behind-the-scenes voice, or he was who made other, you know, bands kind of great. He was writing and composing, you know, the musicians' parts, and so he was a brilliant composer and really didn't get the credit he deserved. And so I'm sure there was a lot of frustrations there, songs he had written that he had not gotten credit for.
Let's say, for instance, in a perfect world, that he was, you know, healthy. Mm-hmm. Would you have lived a life of wealth, do you think?
I think potentially, because when his star did start to rise, and he did get some credit, and certainly there's some songs, Sunshine Alley is one of them on Stanley Turrentine's Sugar album that he got his due credit for. He certainly opened for the largest freshwater aquarium east of the Mississippi at the time, and these were big contracts, like six-figure contracts, where he'd play just for a couple hours. But because of his drug addiction, all that money was wasted on drugs.
So he played for his drugs almost,
exactly.
Didn't he?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so we're gonna come speed it up a little forward and maybe go back a little too to refer back and forth a bit. But I do want to remind you all to please feel free to call in at 919-518-9773 whenever you want to. Or you can come in at Computers2KVoice on Skype and enjoy the conversation. Ask your questions regardless of the question. All questions are great. So please feel free to do that. And also you can go into our chat as well. So now you're in this environment, rat infested, awful, 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 awful. And how do you get out?
So I'm so glad you asked that. So one day I had diffused an argument. My dad was arguing with my mother. At this point, she'd already had non-broken bones, kind of from arguments back and forth that they had, they were, you know, going through. And at this point, I had asked myself, was it even worth living? You know, there were many times we, as kids, we'd be smothered, or we'd, you know, we called hot boxing. We'd stay in the car in the southern heat, you know.
He would lock you in the car?
We would be locked in the car. And he would check on us and take breaks, sometimes crack the window. But you're in the deep south, it's a summer hot day, and you're baking. And so, you know, I kind of was already on the verge of knowing what it was like to lose breath with smothering, or just feeling like we're on the brink of death. And it was at the point of, I could die. And this is a problem. I don't want to die. I don't want this reality that I'm in. It seems to be wrong to me. That's what my heart, my intuition was saying. And certainly there was TV at this time. You could see that there are other realities than I was reading. And so I was aware of safer realities. And I really did not want, my standard was I wanted better. And so this particular argument, my dad wanted to kill my mother. And I diffused the situation. And unbeknownst to me, he said he would take the both of us out and loaded a gun. And luckily, when he fired it at my head, it was partially loaded. The chamber basically, you know, was empty.
Yeah.
Or empty, and pretty much that one.
His intention was to kill you.
His intention was to kill both of us, because after he did that to me, he went to my mother. And at this point, I knew, okay, there's one bullet somewhere in there, and it didn't come out on my head, so it's going to be my mom. And I just knew, my God, I'm going to have to clean up her splattered brains, because we as the kids often would have to clean up the aftermath of their arguments.
I want to ask you a question. I mean, it's just, first of all, when you talk about this, each time you talk about it, how do you feel?
More empowered.
Okay, so you're not shaking, or the memories are not disempowering you?
Initially, when I had not written this and when I wasn't ready to share, I would break down and I couldn't talk about it. And therapy was very hard. Sometimes you feel worse. But after reconciling with kind of what happened and letting it go and realizing there would never be any parental acknowledgement from my father, who's now gone, honestly, I had to move on and take control of my destiny. And so I wrote the story really to give voice to those who are suffering in silence, because we were suffering in silence. And he was this charismatic, like, he literally was loved in the community. And so that day when that partially loaded gun fired on my head, and thankfully on an empty chamber, I cried for help. I had to come up with a plan to get out. The phones were tapped, so I had to take a walk with the dogs with a quarter. At that time, there were pay phones. So I had that quarter, and that quarter was like my salvation. And I called my friend. I told her what was going on, and then I waited.
Oh, my gosh.
Yep.
So then what?
So then, I'll never forget this, on a fall day, English class on campus, because at this point I was going to a very good school. I was able to maintain my grades because I was hiding the pain in my work. And so I was an overachiever. And so I'm at a good school at this point. And I got the note to come to the principal's office.
So who did you call with the quarter?
My friend.
Okay, did you say that yet?
I don't know if I did.
No, let's back up.
Okay.
No, and listen, the book is much even better than she's telling her own story.
Aww.
Go ahead.
Yeah.
So the quarter, you called a friend.
I called a friend, my friend, and I said to her that we were being tortured physically, emotionally, sexually, that at this point I had, before the call, there was an attempted rape, and so I knew that it would only be a matter of time that I would be raped because he'd had older daughters from a previous marriage that had been. And so I wanted out, and I told her to get me out. I asked her. I cried for her to get me out. And thankfully, which asking for help is very hard to do, but thankfully she did mention this to her mom. And then roughly a week or two later is when I got the note to go to the principal's office.
So what'd you do in that week?
Oh, my gosh. I thought I dreamed it. I couldn't believe I had made the call, that I had spilled the beans.
I was scared.
I was thinking, oh, my gosh, what if no one comes to save us? How do I ask? What if, you know, her parent doesn't believe me because he was well respected and loved in the community. So I had to start detaching myself and really just dissociating a little bit to kind of protect really my mind. And, you know, but I was definitely scared. And honestly, I think at that point it was a mixture of emotions. I was so scared, but I was also fed up and tired that had I not gotten a response, I was willing to take it to a teacher or to someone else because I wasn't going to stop until I was safe.
You know, there are people who reach that point where they are, you know, you're so desperate and so out of what you think may be a resource. But you know what? You can, at any time, you can pick your head up. If you're listening to this story and you are in a terrible situation, then you know there's somebody around, somebody, I don't care who it is, a friend, somebody you just passed at the grocery store, mm-hmm. there's somebody that's willing to lend a helping hand, mm-hmm. you know, and, you know, but the point of this story is regardless, I mean, whether you have been down that road similar to Jamila or not, regardless of where you are in your life, there is something that can come next. And that's where we're going next. Okay, so it was awful. So you get out, your friend helps you with what, you know, and then you end up, and we're not going to tell you everything. You got to read the book. Show them the book first.
Yes. So
now we're showing the book. So
this is the book.
There we go.
Yay. Can you guys see it?
Yeah.
Yay.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay, awesome. So you get out.
Yes.
And you're mm-hmm. You're living in with a foster yeah. mother, a white foster
uh-huh.
mother. That
I
was
did.
A challenge in living from where you were to living with somebody mm-hmm. white. Mm-hmm. And then, go ahead.
So it was, in the beginning, it was like rotating through, you know, some bad homes. And in fact, I stayed with my friend for a little bit, but then I made a bad decision to run away to meet up with my mom and dad because my mom wanted to see me, and that had some unintended consequences. So then I was placed in a shelter, and during the shelter stay, there was a lot of bullying going on, and honestly, I just kind of wished I could dissolve into the pain of the wall there. So a lot of bullying and, you know, just kind of maltreatment there. Did that for a couple months and then rotated through some other homes that were toxic, and then landed in my Garden at Lightem's colleague's home. I looked at my Garden at Lightem and I just said, look, I don't care if the next person's purple, white, whatever. I need to be safe. I just inherently knew that safety was necessary for me to grow. I knew that intuitively, and that's what I wanted. I was hiding in my books and doing well academically, but I wanted to be safe. I felt like there was a ceiling and I was kind of caged in because I wasn't safe.
So you did whatever you did, which mm-hmm. was a lot, and you find yourself in medical school.
Yes.
Okay. So now in medical school, how extraordinary is that to go from where you were mm-hmm. to medical school?
Yes. So I tell you, I had this goal, and I think the goal comes from seeing what addiction did to my family and seeing that along the way, there were some caring adults. One of them was my pediatrician. There were several teachers at the school that I was going to. And during those challenges in foster care, one of the goals that I had, because I was talented in the biological sciences, was to understand the human ecosystem, mind, body, soul, and how to build resilience in families. And that was something that I wanted to passionately either research about and be a researcher or become a physician and research and teach in that way.
Did you have a role model or mentor? Do you think it's necessary?
It is necessary. So my mentor was at my high school and believed in me. And because they believed in me, that helped me to really be in an environment where I could get some feedback and see that, if I, do this, getting a lot of kind of if I do X, then Y happens. And that's very important for youth to get that feedback so that they can develop life skills and problem solving and self-efficacy so that they can believe in themselves. So once safe and around a mentor who would challenge me, but also say, you can do this, get out of your comfort zone, try it. You'll fail sometimes, but you need that feedback so you know what to do next time. Really helped build my confidence. And it helped me to feel like, you know what, I can be what I want to be. And I can, with hard work, do kind of, accomplish those goals. It helped me to really know that it starts within, and it helped me to discover my values, which are very important to being motivated about what you want to do in life and living your life in purpose.
And so considering where you have come from mm-hmm. and where you are today, do you believe that there is something that that people can do and accomplish a rebirth?
Absolutely. And so with this drive, I've got to be a researcher, I've got to be a physician, one or the other. It's got to be in the sciences, and it's got to be something where I can help families to overcome addiction and be available. I truly believe that when you look at nature, it's resilience is all in us. And when you look at nature and even the ecosystem of, let's say, the forest, trees are spaced out where they've got healthy boundaries so that they can grow. They have to have the proper light in shade depending on their needs to grow. And so the environment is very, very important to how we as humans and as children, grow. And the brain's very neuroplastic. It can change, and it's based on your caregivers. And all you need is one adult who's supportive that can help that interplay between what's going on inside biologically and what's happening in the environment for you to grow. And so I truly believe that is our opportunity to rebirth into whom we desire to be. It takes a reboot. And then, and that's where you identify the problem and you, you know, come to terms that you're either hurting or there is a problem. And then you strategize through repair. And then truly through that strategy, you have that plan to execute. And that's what rebirth is about. And so I see it in nature, and we are literally a reflection inside, starting inside and going outward. So it's like a mirror. So what we see out also happens inside.
So how have you, so, I mean, this program that you talk about, you've taken this on as your own guiding star. I mean, how do you continue where you are now and continue the hope that you have, the, you know, of going forward, of, you know, of from where you've been? I mean, it's extraordinary, really. Mm-hmm. So what do you do?
So what I do, I had the reboot twice. And so reboot, repair, rebirth is not linear. It's cyclical, much like everything in nature. So you're looking outside in nature again. The answers are out in nature. You just have to study and be silent. So I take time to be silent, and I make sure I'm balanced in four core areas, which is being, body, business.
Being what?
Being. Okay. So your being, your spirit, your soul, your body. Balance, which is relationships and business. And those are four core areas that I was taught by a coach to touch each day, because each day is a new opportunity. And if you touch those four areas, then you are tapping into your resilience, and it's going to be expressed in such a way that you're able to love yourself and then give that back, that love back. Through reboot, when I did the first reboot, it was, I've got to get out of here. I'm not safe. I'm hurting. My mom doesn't realize we're hurting, but I could see it. And, you know, when you can see, that's when awareness, we're aware, and then we can shift and reorganize and change. Once you move into repair, it's a lot of work and commitment and strategy, really, but you can't do it alone. So you need partner, you need accountability or trusting sounding board or someone who is advocating for you. And really it's part of your process because we've run out of steam and we need to be properly nourished and we need to rest to kind of, you know, keep that commitment and really live from the heart. And so repair is understanding your feelings and learning to feel again and learning to be attuned and listen and live from the heart. And that way you learn to love self so that you can give back under rebirth.
So reboot is kind of like shutting it off, right? And then turning it back on.
Mm-hmm. That's right.
Okay. So somebody would do, in shutting it off, would be leaving, would be, you know, finding a safe space to go to. And
correct.
And look, this is something that you would, it's like getting silent, right?
Exactly.
You're going silent, you're going off the grid for a weekend or a day or an hour. You know, that's rebooting. Mm-hmm. I mean, you know, there's all levels to what we're talking about. You know, Dr. Battle's history is extensive, right? Mm-hmm. I mean, that's a major, that's major, right? Mm-hmm. Some of us may just be overwhelmed from the week or may have issues in a relationship or financial issues. It's about getting quiet, you know, taking a step back, shutting off the computer, going away for a night. It may even be about going out for dinner, right? It may be about deciding you don't want to cook for a little while. It's just getting to a point of, okay, let me assess this, shutting it off.
That's right.
Right?
And you're not able to assess when you're distracted. So there's so many distractions that we don't have our attention focused on the problem. So when we're silent, that's when you have greater access to your mind, your wise mind, and it's like a switch. It's like turning the sympathetic system off, which is fight or flight, and turning the opposite system on. And so when you kind of let the mind in silence expand, you come up with the answers on what to do. It's really a gift. And so part of my being is to make sure I meditate first thing in the morning. And because that's very important, I time it, meaning I schedule it. Other tasks, I tag to old habits so that they become new habits. And then you want to reward yourself because we're all creatures of learning, memory, reward, motivation. And so I'm building all those in. But it's reboot certainly could be silence. It can be getting safe. It's the first step when we need to listen and kind of figure out, okay, how do I identify what's going on? How do I become present and understand the present? It requires reboot and being safe. And when you're in the present, you need to ask then, where am I and how did I get here? And that's really how you get to the root to understanding how to strategize next, which is what you do in repair. And it's going to be repairing your mindset. It's going to be repairing, or learning how to process feelings and emotions. It's going to be self-care so that because it's hard work, you have proper nutrition and rest to continue. It's going to be your team, your accountability partners. Once you have this process and the strategy laid out, then you execute, and that's part of rebirth, the doing of your plan. It's so nice because under repair, I was able to find out what my real values were. Under reboot and repair, once I got silent, I understood what my values were, and then under repair, part of the plan was aligning my actions with my values so that I could truly live in my purpose. And so it's nice to then under rebirth be in a place where you learn to maintain, become so to speak, sharing and giving back, and in a way, because now you love yourself, you're able to love others. And a big piece of that is healthy boundaries, so that you can continue to do the work and maintain what you've created. And sometimes we have to reboot over and over again, and that's okay. But it's a framework so that we can understand the process. It's with everything in life. It's a get quiet, safe space, and that's identifying the problem. The awareness is then on the problem so that you can reorganize and change.
Reboot, repair, and what was the last one?
Rebirth. My favorite.
Yeah. So, reboot might mean you have to leave a relationship. And I think that the more, Jamila was saying, the more you do that, the easier I think it becomes to reboot, and to know what you need to do in taking care of yourself. If you know that exercise is a good thing, then it's to remember. Sometimes we get so caught up in life that we kind of put aside the things that we know are good for us, but we somehow lose track of time for them, and we put our time into other things. But then we know, I've always loved to do this. I want to do this. Or I've always loved eating this. I'm just going to eat this. And you know what? That I know that. And then living the joy of what you have, what you found out about yourself or the world around you. So this is a really, really great system, I would think.
I believe so, because there are lots of, anyone can do this. There are lots of times I found myself, when I was silent, rebooting, thinking, gosh, I just feel like I'm living mundanely and just kind of doing the same things over and over again. And I wanted to see some changes. And so when I was in those this space of silence, you know, that was when I did a big kind of overhaul after my third baby, and I got sick and almost died. And I said, look, I've got to work, you know, in a way that I feel motivated, you know, that I feel that's aligned in my value. And so I had to look at what were my values and kind of go back to the drawing board, really, understanding the present and how I got here. And although I was very proud of myself for doing undergrad, you know, by myself, working two jobs, putting myself through medical school, I was very proud of those accomplishments, training. I wasn't practicing intentionally in the way that I wanted to, which is really to have time to listen to the patients and be attuned and empathize and provide that compassion to them as I had provided to myself. So I wanted to teach these things, and in that current health system that I was working in, I did not have the time to do so. So I had to kind of just go, what I do, drawing board, and then find, ask for help and come up with a strategy so that I had that momentum and that power behind me to keep going and not run out of steam to create what I have now.
So, and then we want to get to that. So what do you have now?
So now I have the book, which Blood, Sweat, Tears. This tells you the steps I took to literally go from hell to a piece of heaven, to go from abuse to abundance, to live intentionally, to live your life of purpose. And so I don't sugarcoat the pain, and I tell it in a way where I put my mistakes in there as well, so that you can understand that it takes work. You don't have to be perfect. You will fall, but you learn from those falls. So where I am now is in a space where I have healthy boundaries. Before, I did not. And, you know, I still have to learn to maintain those and keep them healthy. But I have an assistant who helps me with that, a coach that helps keep me accountable. I train for triathlons, and that's a part of integrating body and being, because it's keeping my body healthy.
Okay, I want to interrupt. So it does take help.
It does.
And the thing about it is, when you surround yourself, and it doesn't matter, just whatever little bit of help you might need, whether it's help cooking dinner, people love really in the long run to help. And if they don't, they're not the right people in your life. So, you know, whether you need an assistant, or you need somebody just to help you with breakfast in the morning, or you reach out to your kids and you say, you know what, you're old enough to make your lunch now. It's good for everybody. Mm-hmm. Everybody benefits from reciprocal help. So just keep that in mind, okay? So you're working on doing a training, right?
Yes.
Okay, so tell everybody about that. Also, and just, you know, how they would find you and what they would find when they found you.
Mm-hmm. So part of working on the training is taking the book and then literally blueprinting how to do reboot, how to do repair and rebirth. So everything's written, worksheets are written, and now it's a matter of finding the time and space, as you know, to shoot video. So that this is available to people who want to be in the community of Reboot, Repair, Rebirth, but also available if you choose not to be in the community, really to supplement with any type of healing or transformation or recovery that you desire. That I am also beta testing right now as well, so that when it launches, it's kind of a living course. There will be feedback and It will, you know, change kind of based on what it needs.
But, if you're interested and it's not complete yet, but you certainly can reach out to Dr. Battle and be put on her list, so that when she is complete with this training, because all of this is new, then you can be somebody on her list. So why don't you give them that information as well?
So you can go to my website at www.drjbattle.com. There you can sign up to Reboot, Repair, Rebirth. And as soon as the course is available, you can even be one of those that can get it for low cost. When it unveils, it will be at a low introductory cost. So joining that community. Also, I blog about how to be healthy in your being, body, and your balance, your relationship, and business. Doing triathlon training is a part of what I do to be grounded and be healthy in my being and body. And then there's also good free resources available as well on how to ask for help if you're hurting or doing the hurting or suffering with addiction. Also, last but not least, I have an addiction practice. You can find more information about that on the website. And I also work for a sleep clinic. So if you're suffering with brain fog, insomnia, things like that, you can find information on my website as well.
So obviously, so no matter where you are, is the doorway in. And the best way to begin is to take a time out. Assess. Maybe you don't know where you're going. Maybe you don't know who to ask. Maybe you don't even know where you've come from. You just know it's just not working. Take a time out. Give yourself a few moments. Give yourself some time to figure, you know, just to get a handle of, okay, this really seems like it's out of whack, and work from there. So now where would they get your book?
So the book should be in major bookstores, also on Amazon and Kindle. It's available on Kindle. But it's essentially, although I'm self-published, it's essentially available, widely distributed in any major bookstore. So,
that's good. Yeah. Okay, so now you are a psychiatrist.
A family physician.
Family physician. Mm-hmm. Okay, so if somebody is in San Francisco and they're having problems, what would they do?
That is a good question, because right now my practice is local. It's not set up to provide care nationally yet, but if someone certainly wanted to reach out had questions or were looking for, you know, a coach or an advocate, they could reach out to me. For the resources on the course, that's meant to be a self-help tool. Certainly they could sign up for that, and as I expand that course, certainly it will become, you know, it will grow. It's a living kind of document. So they certainly could have that available to them as well.
And if you know of any place where Dr. Battle can speak about this, it's really important to take it to all ears. So keep her in mind for that as well. So you now, you're a wife, you're a mother, you have this practice. What's it like being a mother coming from where you've come from?
So I had to take a parenting class because I did not know how to be a mother, but I was aware of the brain and the fact that the brain keeps developing when the baby's born. And a lot of what happens in the brain next after the baby's born has to do with what the caregiver is doing. Oftentimes that wiring, those neurons, they grow and branch out based on what's going on in the environment. And if there's a lot of trauma, unresolved trauma that I had, that now, unbeknownst to me, I potentially could have been expressing, that my child could carry that genetically. So those genes could be turned on if my child wasn't nourished. And so that's called epigenetics. I talk a lot about that and the connection between trauma and genetics and expressing protective genes by nurturing and loving and buffering stress. And so our brains can change, and I knew the importance of providing a nurturing environment, but I had to learn that. So I had to take a parenting class. And it is hard. I tell you, I have to delegate a lot to do what I do and be an effective mother and ask for help. And so I, luckily, my better half is, you know, able to support me. He stays at home and he does a lot of the groundwork. And now I'm kind of, I'm there to be available for helping out. He really has done an effective job.
So this is really interesting because, you know, we only know what we know. And we sometimes don't know what we don't know, but we want to know something. And what I admire so much about you, Jamila, is that you are open to learning and to getting the help you need and to, you know, use your own resources that you have within you to do the work, but at the same time to get help and to learn. And it would make sense that you would not maybe know how to parent.
Exactly.
That makes sense. You know, it makes perfect sense.
Exactly. Scared to death.
Yeah, I mean, who do you learn good parenting from?
Right.
Not your grandmother, not your mother, not your father. Who'd you learn it from? And you were locked up.
Right.
So you didn't, wasn't like you went out with your parents, you know, to visit friends or church and you saw other things. You didn't see that.
Exactly.
So you had to learn, literally, had to parent, or had to be a person, didn't you?
I did, absolutely. How to be social again, how to love myself, how to forgive so that I could love myself, how to be compassionate, because there was, I judged myself in a lot of shame and guilt, and that happens with victims of violence. And if you've, you know, if you live here on earth, there's no one that hasn't been disappointed or, you know, we've been traumatized in some way to some varying degree. And so I literally had to learn how to be compassionate to myself and say, you know, I'm this way because of what happened to me, not I'm a bad person. And so with a desire to break the cycle, really, because my dad had been victimized, I traced it back, and that carries and that passes into the DNA. To break the cycle, it starts with compassion to self, an openness and a vulnerability to want to learn, so that you can, you know, do the right thing and provide a nurturing environment and healthy boundaries.
So now, like, when you think of a big dream, what's your biggest dream now?
Oh, my goodness, to write more books, to speak about resiliency. It's a fascinating field. To write more courses, to be like Oprah one day. To have the book become a movie. It is a phenomenal story. The editors did a great job really dropping you into scenes. Like, it's fast paced. I thank my team, and I really want to just continue this. I feel like I'm in part of this dream now. I haven't woken up yet or something, but truly to continue to get the story out so that people can be inspired to change, to get help. Because really you have to ask yourself big questions. Are you being abused? Is substance abuse around you? You know, are you using substances, and what pain are you covering up? And asking those questions, getting silent so that your own intuition can stir and you can identify the root. Where are you and how did you get there, and come up with a plan? But it's to continue to really tell the story and help others so that they can really truly go through their reboot, repair, and rebirth. And get to a place where they can share their stories. Everyone has a story and give back. And I just was just so thankful for my team, and they energize me, and I couldn't do it without them. I couldn't do it without my husband, my assistant, my coach, We all need accountability partners, and when we're losing steam, some kind of inspiration to keep going.
We need each other is what it boils down to. I mean, literally, we're all, you know what? There's a great book, and I love the title. Elizabeth Lesser, some people may have heard about her. She is the co-founder of the Omega Institute up in Rhinebeck, New York, which has been around for many years. It's this amazing facility where they do all kinds of trainings and workshops and seminars and all kinds of stuff. And she wrote a book many years ago, and the title is Broken Open. So it takes going through torture sometimes, God knows, mm-hmm. forgive me. But it does, or it takes some bad things, or it takes some not so bad things that don't feel so good to break open. But in her book, she says, we're all bozos on the bus. So we're all tripping on ourselves. But the point is, let's trip together. Mm-hmm. You know, let's, like Jamila did, reach out, ask somebody who, you know, plays tennis a little better than you. How do you make this? How do you do this? How have you understood this? How have you come to this? Because, you know, sometimes we are a fish out of water. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I wrote a book, and it's new. It's on Amazon. I want to share it. And it's, you know, it's all about stories. And this one is called, you can find it on Amazon, In Just One Afternoon, Listening Into the Hearts of Men. And it's about the stories of 22 men, and it's their story. And I am not a proficient writer. That is not what I have practiced. I've practiced speaking. I have not practiced writing. And I've had some help, but this is their stories. And these stories are great. You may pick it up and not read it all. Maybe you read a piece of a story. It's like an anthology, a roadmap. And there's all kinds of stories from, you know, simple ones to real complex ones. And I've heard from women that they're reading it with their husbands. I've heard from men that they're just reading it and picking up piece by piece. But, you know, in just one afternoon, anything is possible. You know, so reach out and get that book. And if I can answer any questions for you, please feel free to connect with me at marilyn@marilynshannon.com. And my website is marilynshannon.com. And I, you know, so anyway, in closing, how would you like to leave our audience?
Just, you know, now that I've become a triathlete, I'm so proud of that because I've lost lots of weight, 40 pounds, and I still have 30 more to go. But it really is about challenging yourself, because when we challenge ourselves, we become different people and we transcend. And so I see it in triathlon training. You know, first I couldn't swim, just only 25 yards, and now I can do over 1,000. And I hated running, and now I love it. You know, I couldn't bike a hill, and now I can. And so that's what life is about, challenging and asking yourself, what if? Moving towards your opposite, getting out of your comfort zone, being flexible, adaptable, and sticking to or scheduling tasks that need to get done. And so I want to leave with resilience. It's in all of us. When we look at what it takes to be resilient, it's flexibility, adaptability. It's having accountability partner or your team. It's being open to change and learning. It's moving towards your opposite. It's maybe looking at expectations and seeing if those need to be challenged. And truly, that's how we grow.
It's getting uncomfortable. Sometimes it's getting uncomfortable. And Jamila said, getting out of your box. Where are the directions mm-hmm. out of the box? They're not in the box. The directions to get out of the box are out of the box, right?
Yes, and when you're safe, you're able to access your wise mind and your guidance, and
things happen.
Things just happen,
right? When you go with the flow of the river, when you do the right things for yourself, things fall into place, right?
That
you
is
get
correct.
The right help. Yep. So, Jamila's book, find it on Amazon. Reach out to her personally. She'd love to answer your questions for you and give you some help. Find my book on Amazon. We're just a book day, aren't we? Well, you know what? It is out of my box. This is not my box. My box is talking about this, Writing it is not my box, but it's a great book. So I want to thank Jamila today for being here.
Thank you so
much. Oh, it was great having you.
Oh.
Thank you.
Yay.
And thank you, all of you, for being with us today. And we look forward to seeing you, being with you each and every week that we're here. Have a fabulous week. Remember to connect with me anytime at Marilyn@MarilynShannon.com. Reach out to me and tell me your stories. Mwah. Bye.
're tuned to the Nissan Communications Network. And if you tuned in too late, you can always watch each program in its entirety or download an MP3 audio file of it in the archives section on nissancommunications.com. Don't forget to subscribe to our YouTube channel, follow us on Twitter, and like us on Facebook. Sponsored by Atomos.com, makers of quality video recorders and converters, CarolinaApparel.com, and DeltaForce.net.